Hey everybody, did you know you can go to colinmullen.com in order to get art and art prints? That's why I set up the website, and yeah, just hit me up if you want to get some art, colinmullen.com. So hey everybody, gonna do something a little bit different today. I've been reading Creepypasta on stream, and just, I don't know, I thought, hey, you know what? If I can't think of something to talk about, why not just read some cool stories? So this video is going to be a little bit longer. So I'm going to go ahead and mention right up at the top, go ahead and subscribe. It'd be great if you did. If you enjoy this, let me know. If you don't enjoy this, let me know. And if you really enjoy this, there is a Patreon. The link is in the description. I'll thank all those people at the end of this video. But I thought for a first time out, let's do something classic. Let's do some Edgar Allan Poe. Because, I don't know, Poe is good. Doesn't have to be creepy stories, but I don't know. If you guys have any recommendations, let me know. One thing that one of my art teachers in school made us do was just listen to her read a book. It wasn't a particularly interesting book. Something about bees. I don't remember. Anyway, I figured that this is a way to maybe inspire you guys to do art because you're seeing art happen and you have something to listen to while you're doing art. I don't know. Maybe that works for you. Works for me. I always like to listen to stuff. Anyway, enough rambling. The Red Death had long devastated the country. No pestilence had ever been so fatal, or so hideous. Blood was its avatar and its seal, the madness and the horror of blood. There were sharp pains and sudden dizziness, then profuse bleeding at the pores with dissolution. Scarlet stains upon the body, especially upon the face of the victim, were the pest ban which shut him out from the aid and the sympathy of his fellow men. And the whole seizure, progress, and termination of disease were all incidents of half an hour. But the Prince of Prospero was happy, dauntless, and sagacious. When his dominions were half depopulated, he summoned to his presence 1,000 hale and light-hearted friends from among the knights and dames of his court, and with these retired into deep seclusion of the crenellated abbeys. This was an extensive and magnificent structure, the creation of the prince's own eccentric and august taste. A strong and lofty wall girdled it in. This wall had gates of iron, and courtiers, having entered, brought furnaces and massy hammers and welded the bolts. They resolved to leave the means neither of ingress nor egress to sudden impulses of despair or frenzy from within. The abbey was amply provisioned. While the precautions of the courtiers might bid defiance to contagion, the external world could take care of itself. In the meantime, it was folly to grieve or to think. The prince had provided all the appliances of pleasure. There are buffoons, there are improvisatori, there are ballet dancers, there are musicians, there is beauty, there is wine. All these and security were within. Without was the Red Death. It was towards the close of the fifth or sixth month of his seclusion that the Prince of Prospero entertained his 1,000 friends at a masked ball of the most unusual magnificence. The voluptuous scene, that masquerade. But first let me tell you of the rooms which it held. There were 7, an imperial suite, and in many palaces, however, such suites form long, straight vista, while the folding doors slide back nearly to the walls on either hand, so that the view of the whole extent was scarcely impeded. Here the case was very different, as might have been expected from the Duke's love of the bizarre. The apartments were so irregularly disposed that the vision embraced but little more than one at a time. There was a sharp turn at the right and left, and in the middle of each wall, a tall and narrow Gothic window looked out upon a closed corridor, of which perused the windings of the suite. These windows were stained glass, whose color varied in accordance to the prevailing hue of the decorations of the chamber into which it opened. That at the eastern extremity was hung, for example, in blue. Vividly blue were the windows. The second chamber was purple in its ornaments and tapestries, and here the panes were purple. The third was green throughout, and so were the casements. The fourth was furnished and lighted with orange, and the fifth white, and the sixth violet. And the seventh apartment was closely shrouded in black velvet tapestries that hung all over the ceiling and down the walls, falling heavy folds upon the carpet of the same material and hue. But in this chamber only, the color of the windows failed to correspond with his decorations. The panes were scarlet, a deep blood color. Now in no one of any of the 7 apartments was there any lamp or candelabrum. Amid the profusions of gold ornaments that lay scattered to and fro depended from the roof. There was no light of any kind emanating from lamp or candle within the suite of chambers, but in the corridors that followed the suite. There stood, opposite each window, a heavy tripod bearing a brazier of fire that projected its rays throughout the tinted glass and so glaringly lit the room, and thus were produced a multitude of gaudy, fantastic appearances. But in the western or the back chamber, the effect of the firelight that streamed upon the dark hangings through that of the blood-tinted panes was ghastly in the extreme, and produced so wild a look upon the countenances of those who entered that there were few of the company bold enough to set foot into the precincts at all. It was within this apartment, also, that there stood against the western wall a gigantic clock of ebony. The pendulum swung to and fro with a dull, heavy, monotonous clang. When the 1 minute hand made the circuit to the face, and the hour was to be stricken, there came from the brazen lungs of the clock a sound which was clear, loud and deep, exceedingly musical, but of so peculiar a note and emphasis that, at each lapse of the hour, the musicians of the orchestra were constrained to pause, momentarily in their performance, to hearken to the sound. And thus the waltzers perforce ceased their evolutions, and there was a brief disconcert of the whole gay company. And while the chimes of the clock yet rang, it was observed that the giddiest grew pale, and the more aged and sedate passed their hands over their brows as if in confused reverie or meditation. But when the echoes had fully ceased, a light laughter at once pervaded the assembly. The musicians looked at each other and smiled, as if at their own nervousness and folly, and made whispered vows, each to the other, that the next chiming of the clock should produce in them no similar emotion. And then, after a lapse of 60 minutes, which embraced 3,600 seconds of time that flies, there came yet another chiming of the clock, and then were the same disconcert and tremulousness and meditation as before. But in spite of things, it was gay and magnificent revel. The tastes of the Duke were peculiar. He had a fine eye for the color and effect, disregarded the decora of mere fashion. His plans were bold and fiery. His conceptions glowed with barbaric luster. There were some who would have thought him mad. His followers felt that he was not. It was necessary to hear and see and touch him to be sure he was not. He had directed in great part the movable embellishments of the seven chambers upon occasion of the great fete, and it was his own guiding taste which had given character to the masquerades. Be sure they were grotesque. There were much glare and glitter and piquancy and phantasm, much of which had been seen in Hernani. It was an arabesque figures with unsuited limbs and appointments. There are delirious fancies of a madman's fashions. There is much of the beautiful, much of the wanton, much of the bizarre, something of the terrible, and not a little of that which might have excited disgust. To and fro in the seven chambers stalked, in fact, a multitude of dreams, and these, the dreams, writhed in and out, taking hues from the rooms and causing the wild music of the orchestra to seem as the echo of their steps. And the anon, there strikes the ebony clock which stands in the hall of velvet, and then, for a moment, all is still, and all is silent save for the voice of the clock. The dreams are stiff frozen as they stand, the echoes of the chime die away, they have endured but an instant, and the light, half-subdued laughter floats after them as they depart. And now the music swells, and the dreams live, and they rise to and fro more merry than ever, taking cue from the many tinted windows through which stream the rays of the tripods. But to the chamber which lies most westwardly of the seven, now there are none of the maskers who venture, for the night is waning away, and there flows ruder light through the blood-colored panes, and the blackness of the sable drapery appalls. And to him whose foot falls on the sable carpet, there comes from the near clock of ebony a muffled pearl more solemnly emphatic than any which reaches the ears who indulge in the more remote gaieties of the other apartments. But these other apartments were densely crowded, and in them beat fervishly the heart of life, and the revel went whirling on until at length they commenced the sound of midnight upon the clock. And then the music ceased, as I have told, and the evolutions of the waltzers were quieted, and there was an uneasy cessation of all things before. But now there were 12 strokes to be sounded by the bell of the clock, and thus it happened, perhaps, that more of thought crept, with more time into meditation of the thoughtful among those who reveled. And thus too it happened, that before the last echoes of the last chime had utterly sunk into silence, there were many individuals in the crowd who found leisure to become aware of the presence of a masked figure who had arrested the attention of no single individual before. And the rumor of this new presence had spread itself whisperingly among those who rose at length from the company, a buzz and murmur of horror and disgust. In the assembly of phantoms, as such I have painted, it may be well supposed that no ordinary appearance could have excited such sensation. In truth, the masquerade licensed of night was nearly unlimited. But the figure in question had out-heroded Herod, and had gone beyond the bounds of even the prince's infinite decorum. There are chords in the hearts of the most reckless which cannot be touched without emotion. Even with the utterly lost, to whom life and death are equal jests, there are matters of which no jest can be made. The whole company, indeed, seemingly now deep to feel that in costume and bearing of the stranger neither wit nor property existed. The figure was tall and gaunt, and shrouded from head to foot in the habiliments of the grave. The mask which concealed his visage was made so nearly to resemble the countenance of a stiffened corpse that the closest scrutiny must have been difficult to detect the cheat. And yet, all this might have been endured, if not approved, by the mad revelers around, but a murmur had gone so far as to assume the type of the Red Death. His vesture was dabbled in blood, and his broad brow, with all the features of his face, was bespreckled with scarlet horror. The eyes of the Prince of Prospero fell on the spectral image, which was slow and solemn movement, as if fully sustaining its role, stalked to and fro among the waltzers. He was seen to convulse, in the very moment, with a strong shudder, either of terror or distaste, but in the next his brow reddened with rage. "Who dares," he demanded hoarsely of the courtiers who stood near him, "who dares insult us with his blasphemous mockery? Seize him and unmask him, so that we may know who among we have to hang at sunrise from the battlements." It was in the eastern or blue chamber in which stood Prince Prospero as he uttered these words. They rang throughout the seven rooms so loudly and clearly, for the prince was a bold and robust man, and that the music had become hushed at the waving of his hand. It was in the blue room where stood the prince and the group of pale courtiers by his side. At first, as he spoke, there was a slight rushing of movement of this group in the direction of the intruder, who, at the moment, was near at hand, but now, with deliberate and stately step, made closer approach to the speaker. But from the certain nameless awe with which the mad assumptions of the murmur had inspired within the whole party, there were found none who would put forth a hand to seize him, so that unimpeded he passed within a yard of the prince's person, and while the vast assembly, as with one impulse, shrank from the centers of the room to the walls, he made his way, interrupted, but in the same solemn and measured step that he had distinguished from the first, through the blue chamber to the purple, from the purple to the green, through the green to the orange, through this again to the white, and thenceforth to the violet, ere a decided movement had been made to arrest him. It was then, however, that the Prince Prospero, maddening with rage and shame of his own momentary cowardice, rushed hurriedly through the six chambers, which none followed him on account of a deadly terror that had seized them all. He bore aloft a drawn dagger and approached in rapid impetuously to within 3 or 4 feet of the retreating figure, when the latter, having attained the extremity of the velvet apartment, turned suddenly and confronted his pursuer. There was a sharp cry, and the dagger dropped gleaming upon the sable carpet, upon which most instantly afterward fell prostrate in death the Prince Prospero. Then, summoning the wild courage of despair, a throng of revelers at once threw themselves into the black apartment, and seized the murmur whose tall figure stood erect and motionless within the shadows of the ebony clock, gasped in unutterable horror at finding the grave cerements and corpse-like mask, which they handled with so violent a rudeness, unintentiated by any tangible form, and now was acknowledged the presence of the Red Death. He had come like a thief in the night, and one by one dropped the revelers in blood-bellowed halls of their revel, and died each in despair, posture of his fall, and the life of the ebony clock went out with that of the last of the gay, and the flames of the tripods expired, and darkness and decay, and the Red Death held illimitable domination over all. It's a good one. Poe did a really good one with that. Very prescient to 2020, 2021 happenings. But hey, if you enjoyed this, let me know. This is definitely a departure for me to go away from the normal art advice and just give you guys something to listen to. A little bit of horror, a little bit of classic horror. 1842, that's wild, man. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching. And hey, if you liked it, you can go to patreon.com in order to throw a couple bucks at me. If you donate $5 or more, you get your name in the credits. But thank you to everyone who donates on Patreon, no matter how much. But extra special thank yous to the following people. Thank you, Wapfu. Thank you, Top Houndor. Thank you, Targo. Thank you, Spencer Kane. Thank you, Snoutpunk. Thank you, Orthogonal Caster. Thank you, Mortibus. Thank you, Micah. Thank you, Maliciousness. Thank you, Lost Nevada. Thank you, Kayla Hollinger. Thank you, Katana Squirrel. Thank you, Josh. Thank you, Gala. Thank you, Dragon. Thank you, Demetrius Gazgales. Thank you, Chiptune Glitch. Thank you, Bubba Fair. Thank you, Pep. Thank you, Andy. Thank you, Amber. And thank you, Ants! Again, very much of a departure from my regular thing, aesthetically, in the video and in the painting. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, let me know. If you didn't, let me know. And we'll go from there. But anyway, I'll see you guys in the next one.